Hachette Audio presents Cross My Heart, written by James Patterson, read by Michael Boatman and Tom Wopat.
Prologue. Twas the night before Easter. I trudged aimlessly through the dark, empty streets of Washington, haunted by the memory of my son, Ali, telling me that the only way to kill a zombie was to destroy its brain. It was 3 a.m. Storms punished the city. I'd been walking like that for hours by then, but didn't feel hungry or thirsty or tired in any way. When lightning bolts ripped the sky and thunder clapped right over my head, I barely flinched. Not even the pouring rain could slow me or soothe the agony that burned through every inch of my body because of what had been done to my family. With every step, I kept seeing Ali, Bree, Damon, Janny, and Nana Mama in my mind. With every step, the horror of what had happened to them ignited inside me all over again, and loneliness and grief and anger. Is this what Thierry Mulch wanted? I kept asking myself. Thierry Mulch had destroyed everything I loved, everything I believed in. He'd gutted me and left a dead, soulless man doomed to endless, meaningless movement. As I walked, I kept hoping Mulch or some anonymous street predator would appear and blow my head off with a shotgun or crush it with an axe. There was nothing I wanted more than that. Part 1. 16 days earlier. Chapter 1.
Sitting in a parked work van on 5th Street on a beautiful April morning, Marcus Sunday used high-definition Leica binoculars to monitor Alex Cross's house. I felt a genuine thrill, thinking that the great detective was sure to make an appearance sometime in the next half hour or so. After all, it was a Thursday and 7:30 in the morning. Cross had to work, so did his wife, and his children had school to attend. Sunday had no sooner had that thought than Regina Cross Hope, Cross's 91-year-old grandmother, came up the sidewalk from the direction of St. Anthony's Catholic Church. The old bird was tough and moving at a surprising clip despite the cane. She walked right by his van, barely gave it a glance. Then again, why would she? Sunday had attached magnetic signs to the van that advertised Over the Moon Vacuum Cleaner Company, and behind the tinted glass he was wearing the uniform of said company, a real find at the Salvation Army. Fit perfectly. The used vacuums in the back of the van had been purchased at a secondhand store out in Potomac for $60 apiece. The phony magnetic signs had been ordered online through FedEx office, so had the phony badge on his left shirt pocket. It read, Thierry Mulch. A lithe, fit man in his late 30s with close-cropped salt-and-pepper hair and slate-gray eyes, Sunday checked his watch as Cross's grandmother disappeared inside the house. Then he took up a black binder stowed between the driver's seat and the center console. Flipping it open, he noted the tabs on the first 5 section dividers, each marked with a name. Bree Stone, Ali Cross, Janny Cross, Damon Cross, and Regina Cross Hope, otherwise known as Nana Mama. Sunday went straight to the Regina Cross Hope / Nana Mama section and filled in the exact time the old woman had entered the house and from what direction. Then, waiting for more sightings, he flipped to the back of the binder and found a 4-page copy of the floor plan of the house, which had conveniently been filed with the city planning board last month as part of Cross's application for permits to redo his kitchen and bathrooms. Alternately studying the plan and the house itself, Sunday made notes on the diagrams regarding entries and exits, positions of windows, landscaping, and the like. When Cross's wife, Bree Stone, also a detective with the D.C. Metro Police, came out on the porch to fill a bird feeder at 7:40, he recorded that act as well, and the fact that her backside looked glorious in a tight pair of jeans. At 7:52, a truck bearing a logo that read, "Dear Old House," pulled up in front of Cross's house, followed by a waste disposal company hauling a construction dumpster. Out came the great detective onto the porch to greet the contractors and watch the unloading of the dumpster. So did his grandmother, his wife, and two of his three children, 15-year-old Janny and 7-year-old Ali. "Nice, happy family," Sunday thought, studying them through the binoculars in turn. "The future for them seems bright. Looks full of promise, doesn't it?" Sunday allowed himself a smile, thinking that a good deal of the fun in any adventure lay in the planning, the preparation, and the anticipation. Maybe more than half, he decided, enjoying the way his ever-fertile brain conjured up various dark ways to destroy the dream scenario unfolding before his eyes. Then Dr. Alex left with his kids. The three of them walked past Sunday on the other side of Fifth, but the detective barely looked at the work van. Then again, why would he? Sunday felt deflated after Cross and his children disappeared. It just wasn't as enjoyable scouting the house with a detective absent, almost like looking at a maze in desperate need of a rodent. Sunday checked his watch, shut the binder, and put it away, feeling that he was a free, authentic man with a purpose that would not waver no matter the consequences. He started the van, thinking that wavering in any way was almost an insult to one's opponent. You had to want to destroy your enemy as much as you wanted to destroy you. As Sunday drove off, he believed he was up to his task. He also believed Cross's family deserved the wickedness to come, each and every one of them, especially Dr. Alex.
Chapter 2. In a normal year, the murder rate in Washington, D.C. waits for the stifling days of summer to peak. In July and August, when the air along the Potomac is the consistency and temperature of a rabid dog's mouth, people just seem to snap left and right. In my line of work, you come to expect it. But beginning with the terrorist attack at Union Station on New Year's Day, there had been a steady run of homicides through the winter and on into spring. It was barely April, but this was shaping up already as one of the worst years in 3 decades for homicide in the District of Columbia. That had put enormous political pressure on the mayor and the city council, which meant the Metro Police Chief, too, was under enormous pressure. But the squeeze was especially tight around the homicide and major case squads. Since I was now a roaming investigator for both teams, the non-stop murders meant the biggest squeeze had been put on me and on my partner and closest friend, John Sampson. We had not had a day off in nearly 2 months, and our caseload seemed to grow every day. To make it worse, I was fielding calls from a contractor who was about to remodel the kitchen and put an addition on our house. So the last person I wanted to see around 9:30 that Thursday morning was Captain Roloff Antonius Quintus, who ran homicide. Captain Quintus knocked on the door of my office, where I'd been finishing up a breakfast burrito and a second cup of coffee while looking at a cabinet hardware catalog my wife had shoved into my hand as I left home. Sampson, a locomotive of a man, was on the couch, devouring the last of his morning meal. Sampson saw Quintus and groaned. "Not another one." Quintus shook his head. "I just need an update to take to the chief. The mayor's out of her mind and hounding him nonstop." "We cleared 3 this week, but you handed us 4, I replied. "So the takeaway is that we're making progress but falling behind." "Sounds about right," Sampson said. "Like that king in mythology who keeps pushing the boulder up the hill, only it keeps falling down." "Sisyphus," I said.
Like him, Samson said, pointing at me.
Come on, Cross, Quintus said. We're counting on you to put some of the higher-profile cases like Rollins and Kimmel to bed. Get the post off our backs. Did you see that goddamned editorial?
I had.
Just that morning, they'd run a piece that...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.